我现在是在 Uber 工作，在 Uber 工作了2年多，然后之前是在微软工作了1年半，然后跳过来的 Uber，主要是做那个 data infra 相关
data infra，你做哪一块啊，姐姐？
的。在 Uber 内部是 Flink。
Flink 是吧？Uber 有 Flink 吗？我一直，
有，
有那个 Asana 是吧？Asana
对
是
对
吗？
对对对。
OK，make sense。然后我们这边的话，就是今天讲那个 Facebook Feeds，Facebook Feeds 其实它也 publish 过一些 paper，我觉得比较好的 paper 就是那个淘 Facebook 淘。这篇 paper 还是挺值得大家读一下的。然后，然后这个 Face 淘这篇 paper 呢，就是我9月份的时候，我去年11月的时候加入了一个 Uber 的一个 Strike Team 嘛，当时也是 Silent Legal 的，就不能 disclose 做啥。然后，但是我们当时设计了一个 graph，然后就写了一个 graph 嘛，就写了一个 relationship，然后和这个 Facebook 淘很像，但是我是写完以后呢，读了 Facebook 淘，然后发现其中好多想法是相似的。然后，所以 Facebook Feeds 就是感觉，如果大家感兴趣的话，可以读一篇 paper 叫 Facebook 的那个 TAO，它也是 inspire 了很多 paper 的设计，像 Uber Schemeless 也是这个 TAO inspire 的。然后 Facebook Feeds 的话，还是中间还是有很多优化的，然后还是挺有趣的。那我们现在就开始好了。然后，你晒一下你的 screen，然后这样的话，我们可以看着这个写。OK，so，这块这个 description 呢，我是 copy 的那个，因为我自己不用 Facebook，我 Facebook 基本上我不用 Facebook，我就somehow 不喜欢把我的 data disclose，然后就没有用 Facebook，所以那个我现在的话，这个 Feeds 如果有什么新的 feature，我也不是很熟，上一次用已经好久年了，14年、13年的时候。好，现在的话就是我就 copy 了一个这个 Grokking Interview 的这个 Facebook Feed，我觉得它设计的中间最重要的问题没有解答，但是我们这块的 requirement 是 copy 在那里的，所以呢这块的话 news feed 呢就是 OK，so if we want to design a news feed 的话，news feed should be generated by some posts from other people。
我可以申请一下权限吗？
应该 refresh 一下，应该有的，你应该是有 edit 的权限的，对吧？对，我应该给你了。对，然后OK，let's design a news feed for the Facebook. So the news feed will be generated based on posts from other people and groups, and also page other users follow. And you may have many friends follow a large number of group pages and group. And the feeds may contain image and videos and or just text. And our service support appending new posts as arrived to the news feeds for active users. So it should be real-time adjustable for all the new feeds. And also the posts should be liked by other users and leave comments by other users. So you can also, you can also say you went to some place and then you went to some place and say, for example, I can go to Golden Gate Bridge and leave a post there. And additionally, so you should be able to support you at new ads. That's the main revenue for Facebook. There is actually a lot of details, like user experience details. But let's actually get started. Assume that you want to have a user have non-broken experience. You want to have a good experience. You're going to have a lot of interesting requirement along the way.
Sure. For the first one, like, user may have many friends. What is the average number for the friends?
I think Facebook friends are pretty a lot. It's not like WeChat friend. Let's assume that you have 500,
500.
average 500.
So, how many users is on the Facebook?
I think I read this part. I think they have total user is 2.7 billion. I remember 2.7 billion user.
Well,
2.5 is fine. Yeah. They have that many user. Yeah, it's impressive. Monthly active user.
okay, so for the day active user, how many there? Like
Yeah, so let's for daily active user, let's assume 1 billion maybe.
1 billion. This is still a huge one.
It's a huge one.
Yeah, so I think the requirement here is quite clear. Let's first focus on the, we should have a, how many, like the key functions. So user can post and the user can get feed. And can also comment and like. So for the post one, suppose one user for one day, one user only post one, then the total post should be 1 billion. And for each post, like for the only text post, then that could be 1 KB, it should be enough, right? Can we suppose?
Yeah, 1 KB is probably for text post. That's probably good enough. Average,
okay.
I see.
So for 1 day, the data the storage will be like 1 day. This is a 1 day, like this is 1 KB. This is 1 TB, right?
I think it's around same level, roughly right level, yeah.
Yeah, for 1 day, the data could be 1 TB. And suppose we need to store the data for 5 years. Like,
let's assume that you want to store much longer. I can still see my post like 10 years ago. So you want to store it forever, maybe.
Forever.
Yeah.
But the system could be deprecated in the long run.
System could, well, you can deprecate system, but you can migrate data to your new system, right? You don't want to lose data. Data is everything in Facebook.
Okay. Then we can do this way, like we, every year we'll add a storage to the add a new storage. So we can only estimate the data for 1 year.
It should be dynamically horizontal scalable, right? That's a requirement, right? You want your service to be horizontal scalable.
Yeah, but we will keep adding the storage on that one. Like for the scalability is supported by the architecture. Like we can easily to add storage.
Sounds good.
We don't
Sounds
need
good.
To put all the data, all the storage there in the beginning. So we can support 1 year. So it's around 1 TB. Like we will also have some videos or images. Like for this kind of post, can we suppose like user will have a less post on that one?
I think you actually have more video posts and image posts than the text posts.
Okay. I don't know because I don't use Facebook also.
Yeah, you probably have more image and the video posts than the text posts.
Okay.
So that's a majority of posts, I think.
1 billion. But for the video or the image, it could be much bigger. So can we, for the image, like 1 MB?
It's not, I think here it's, you're storing in different database, unless you want to store in the same database. So the storage size doesn't matter here, in my honest opinion.
Okay, so you mean that we don't need to calculate this kind of things? Anyway, for this kind of files, we can store it in the HDFS. So for the HDFS, it's quite flexible and scalable.
Okay, so this is some part I don't really like. I think it's actually not a good design. So you don't want to start in HDFS because the latency to HDFS are optimized for throughput. It means that it's It means that the throughput for HDFS is a chaos optimization. So it's like a TCP. It means that you can get your transfer throughput maximum, but the latency will be very high. If you're familiar with HDFS, I think some call can take more than 1 minute. So.
Yeah, for the raw HDFS, then we need to find the directory and find the path and get the file. But we can build it based on the HBase.
And
the storage is still rely on the HDFS, but the SQL engine, the will be the HBase.
Okay. I think you can just mention you want to use like the Autobox service like Amazon S3 and maybe add a cache on top of it. That makes more sense. Well, okay. You can build your own service as well if you want to rebuild Amazon S3. That's your choice. But you have a Autobox service you can use.
Sure.
Yeah.
And also like. For the video, it could be larger. This is gonna be a huge storage. And for the QPS, like we have 1 billion user and suppose one post one every day. So And for 1 day, it's about 10,000 seconds. No. 100,000, right. And so the QPS would be 1 billion. So it is about this one for the
Okay, I see. It's a user QPS. That's the right QPS you're trying to see.
Yeah,
that's right QPS. Okay.
So the peak QPS. Let's see. We can multiply 5 or 10, then it's around this one. So for the read, actually for the read QPS, it could be way higher than this one. Let's see, 1 billion user. In 1 day, that could be 10 times to refresh the app or the in the website. So that one would be higher. We can also still use QPS.
Yeah, I think it's a reasonable estimation.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's go to the, firstly, let's go to the API design.
Let's go to architecture. Really interesting architecture here. I want to see how to handle architecture.
Okay, sure. Like, I have this one. So we can draw in on this one. Suppose this is a user and the user can host service. So user one user do the post. You can contact the post service, and for the post service, we need to have a storage. There would be multiple things we need to store. Post itself. And we also need to have the.
Yeah, let's keep the terminology same. Let's call it feed service. It's a feed, right? Yeah. Facebook feed system.
It's feed system, but the user need to first post the post, right? And then for the user, they try to get the feed. Then we have another one we can call it feed service. So this one will contact with user to feed the feeds. We can go to the workflow first. Like
okay.
The user can post one in the post service, and the post service will store the data in the storage. The data contains the post content and who posted this one. And also, like for the post, we can have some video or image. So for that media file, then we can put in another like media story. The basic model can be all the posts are stored in the post storage, and then we have another. We have this feed service. This feed service will get some relationship. Let's see. Relation service. So for this one, it can provide the function like one user. We can find all the followees of this user, and then you get the all. Followees. So then the basic function could be this one to this one can get the all the followees post, and then to do a and then merge all the post for the followees. So one user can request to the feed service periodically, and this one will get the user ID to the relation service. The relation service can get all the user followees. Then the feed service use the followees IDs to query the post storage and retrieve all the data. And here, because all the followees post could be sorted in the either by the timestamp or by the ID of the post, then we can easily merge several we can call it the timeline, right?
Yeah, we can call it user timeline.
So we can merge all the timelines. So this is the basic model. Like it's called the
This is
tree
a,
tryout.
yeah, this, no, this is a relational model. This is a normalized model.
I mean like one user want to get the feed, then it will find out the traffic and to query all the fluids and query all the posts and merge it.
Yeah, this is a normalized model. Okay, let's
Yeah.
give you some questions. Some very interesting question. Let's actually go something simple. How many posts per user you want to fetch?
Like for the Facebook, I'm not sure. Like in one page, it's maybe only 10.
Okay, 10.
And then we can multiple five, so like can 50 posts.
So you want to get 50 posts, and
Yeah.
then how are you going to do it? You have 500 friends here, and how many posts you're going to get for each friend?
Here for each friends, in case some friends doesn't post anything, so at least for each friend, 50.
So you for each of friend for 500 friends, each friend you get 50 posts.
Yeah.
Okay, so now you're actually reading 500 times 50. That's actually 25,000 posts, and as a result, at the end, you only return 50 posts. Okay, so this is first thing, right? Second thing is that, when we want to optimize latency, so you can think of if your request is only reading only one database, it means that most of the time, like P99, probably 10 milliseconds, and
For this one, we don't go into details of this database. There could be the NoSQL, so we don't need to do the sharding. And also, we can also use MySQL or some other RDMs, relational database. Then we can do the sharding on the service level.
but still, you're actually so when you get posts from 500 users, when you get posts from 500 users, you actually do a 500 API call, database call. And if you're looking at the implementation, say this 500 API call, it could go to totally different partition and shardings of the database. So your reading call, one user's reading call, the read, we don't usually see this amplification, but if the read amplification is 500.
So I mean this is a basic design. Then we can also do a fan out to decrease the latency of the news feed.
Okay, yeah, let's see what's optimization, because I highly doubt this design will scale.
So once the user posted the post a survey post then we can do a fan out at this moment. So we don't let the user to actively pull all the posts. Then we can to generate the post line or the news feed line for the followers. Let's see, we have another let's see. This is a post service. Then we can send the post service to fan out service. So this one, it will basically also do the same thing. Like in the relations service, it will request the relation service to get all the followers. Followers. And then for each followers, we can have a post line. This is could be the timeline. And we can also have the post line, like, so we can, we can store all the timeline in the, like, we can see the cache, all the database. So once the post is reached to the fanout service, it will calculate based on the relation and fan out the post to each follower's post line. So when the user come to get the feed, then it can go to firstly to check the post line storage and to direct if there's a post line there for this user, then it could be return the result directly. If not, then we will still go to the basic line to merge, get all the followers and merge all the posts. So for the fanout service, like, it still could have some issue. Like you mentioned in the requirement, there is a page. And for each page, it could have a lot of followers. So like, see, if there's 1 million followers, this fanout will insert to the 1 million users post line. Then it could be a big effort. So for that kind of service, we can also have another, we can call it user tier service. So it's basically store the either user or web page. Like if the user or page have more than 1K or 10K followers, then we consider it as a celebrity. So in the fan out, we don't do the fan out. We'll ignore this service. We'll directly ignore this operation. So if we add this one, then in the feed service, there will be a merge. There will be actual merge service function. So the workflow could be one user come to the feed service, then the feed service will go to the cache and all the database to get the post line for this user. Meanwhile, so it will also check the relationship service to find all the followees, who is the, we can call it a celebrity, who has a large number of the followers. Then we can go to this one to get the large number of followees posts and then do the merge. So here, then we can merge the post line with this one and return to the users.
Yeah, I think this is a hybrid model, or normalized solution and denormalized solution. This is actually also a design very similar to how Twitter is designed, Twitter feeds.
Yeah.
OK，so，这边我还是想说一下，就是这个可能表述相关，就是你刚讲完这个的时候，我就觉得这个就是你表述的时候还是要，就是一上来的时候就说我打算用一个 hybrid model 可能更好一点，就是这样可能更好一点，就表述相关嘛，因为这个你要是刚说完第一个 solution 的话，你的面试官会有很多问题特别这个利用率太低了点，你要是这个利用率太低了，你看这个你读一个 follower 500个 follower，然后每个再读50个 post。读了25000个 post，最后返回50个，这个利用率，这个利用率只有不到0.5%，0.5%左右，这个利用率太低了，所以你肯定得就说一下，我上来就是要一个 hybrid solution，有 normalized 和 denormalized solution，你一上来就把这个这样的话能减少很多的 dots 是吧？对，这个跟表述相关，其实你上来这个小 solution 已经想好了，但是这个跟表述相关，就是你上来还是要这么说的，这个话会影响 perception，可能最后。最后可能其实也没有什么影响，但可能会影响 perception 所以你上来的时候就你想好是个 hybrid solution，你上来就说是个 hybrid solution，这个的话还是很重要的然后我想想这块儿，so how do you handle the additional new feeds? For example, when you read the post, there is a new post coming, and you want to show. You want to, I think when there is a new post coming, you will show someone already uploaded, you know, someone posted a new thing. You want to notify your user. And when you pull the post again, so how do you handle that part? Because all the posts and feeds are ever changing service. It's not like gonna stay there forever.
So you mean when the user, one user already got the post line here, and then one of the following got post a new one, then how do we notify this user?
Yes. How do you notify the user, and what about subsequent rate? How you're going to handle subsequent rate? So, for example, I can give you several scenario. So the first scenario is that you pull the post, and then after 10 seconds, you pull the post again. You pull the feed again. So you pull the feed. After 10 seconds, you want to look at the next page of feed. And another scenario is that you actually open the Facebook and then you left there for a while. After 1 hour, you pull the feed again, right? The third scenario is that you open the feed at early morning and then time goes by and then late afternoon you open the feed again. So how do you handle each of scenarios?
Then that for that one, we will go into the details of the how do we design the data schema, data model. Like for the post line service and the storage, we need to store like for each user, we can have a like suppose we are using the Redis. Actually, I think Twitter use Redis for all this stuff. So like we can use a Redis. Then for each user, it can have a post line. In the post line, it could be a sorted set. And for this one, for sorted set for each one, we can use the post ID. Suppose this post storage will suppose the incremental ID. And also with a timestamp and also the content. Some like one post could contains a photo or the video, then it could have a media links. Then in the beginning, user can query the feed service, then feed service will returns all the post. For each post, it will also have the post ID and timestamp. And also other content media link. Then the media link will user can directly call another media service to get the image or the videos. But for this one, like say, in the morning, he already got a fit. And 1 hour later, he can query the feedback service with, let's see, current host ID and the max timestamp. So use these two key parameters. The feed service can read from the post line storage, and only extract the data bigger than the current post ID. Also, like bigger later than this timestamp.
Sorry, I got confused. So, So you assume that the post ID is actually time indexed.
Yeah.
So the ID actually has timestamp in it.
Yeah.
Okay, so what if you don't have any data? Like you're looking at the new timeline, you pull it very frequently, like 1 minute you feel like 50 posts and you want to pull again.
For this one, when user posts into the post service, it will find out to this cache or this DB, this storage, right?
Yeah.
Like if this is missing here, either this one is already, this service is done, or the service has some legacy here.
So right. My question is that how, so here you actually have a list. Do you want to cap the list or do you want to keep the list ongoing? Like
for this one, it will clean the list for some time.
Okay, so you want to, so the list is actually limited list, right? You will clean it up if it's long, too long ago. Okay,
yeah.
In that case, when you fetch the data, and so help me understand this. Are you going to, the subsequent run, will fetch the more newer data or the older data?
The newer data.
The newer data, okay.
Yeah.
But the first fetch will be the newest data.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So if you pull it subsequently, just, you know, after you pull the first page, you want to look at the second page, you don't get any data there.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you mean this one?
It's timeline, right? So if you get, you know, I think one of the common use cases is that when you look at the first page of data, the second page data is like older post, not like newer post.
Mm-hmm. Then we can, suppose we already see the, like we can have this one. Suppose we already got the first page. Then we have the post ID for this page. And we can take the minimum post ID. And then we can use that one as a parameter to query the feed service. Also, we can add a limit. So it means, like, suppose we have a post 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So for each page, we only return 3. And firstly, it will query with the feed service with nothing. And then we can get the 5, 6, 7. And then when we scroll down in the page, we can take the 5 as the current post ID. So we can also add a limit like 3. So when the feed service get this request, it will check the post ID smaller than the 5 and retrieve 3 posts back to the and return back to the user.
Okay, so here, I don't think, 首先这个 post ID 里面含 timestamp 这个设计有一个 big assumption， 这个 post ID 有可能是 UUID 啊，你不一定是真的含了一个 timestamp， 你不一定是那个 snowflake ID 是吗？那个 Twitter snowflake ID， 所以这个 post ID 含 timestamp 这个设计呢， 有一个 big assumption 就是这个。然后 OK，so 我推荐你不要用这个 post ID 和 timestamp， 因为这个 assumption 不一定所有的公司。我知道 Twitter 的 Snowflake 好像这个 post ID 和 timestamp， 但是不是所有公司都有的。如果不是的话，你可能还是要用其他的那个 determiner， 去看一下这个时间顺序。I think my bigger issue here is that so for example, I think the phase here, assume that you have phase 1, 3, 5, 7 first. You know, that's a initial phase, like 1, 3, 5, 7. The bigger number it is, the higher priority you want to recommend to the user. Assume that, right? You probably want to add some machine learning there.
Okay. You mean?
Because
you mean the post ranking?
Post ranking, right? You want to have some machine learning there to rank the post, to make sure you give the user, because the ultimate KPI for your service is the user, you know, how user gonna do, you know, monthly active user, how user like your platform. You want to recommend user post, posted by people he care or place he care. You know, you want to deprioritize post if it's too negative or some people he don't like, right? So you do have some ranking of post here. But here, let's assume that when you first do the first call, you only have post 1, 3, 5, 7. And then later, when you do the second call, you have 2, 4, 6 inserted. How do you going to return the result?
I think the inserted post should be merged on the feed side, since it could be nearly real time. Like, see, we have another service here. Like could be the ads service. You want to add ads. And also the, interested following. Let's say like, you mark someone as a interested followee. So you, once this guy posted one post, you want to get the notification. And for this one, so we have the base, one user query the feed service, it can have the basic order of the post. And then suppose, firstly, we suppose that all the ads or the interested followees poster is not here. Then we can use some axiom to merge this based on the ranking. Like for example,
I think you still don't get my question. My question is the feed, you know, the ranking of the feed is ever changing, and how do you make sure you return? You don't return repeated feed, and also you want to return the feed like most attractive to the user, and you know, ads could be another thing. Ads could say you can assign ranking score for the ads as well, you know, based on who paid the highest price, right? Right. But general speaking, you want to make sure, you know, assume that you have a feed list of different ranking score, and the source of the feed can come from ad service, posting from ad service, the posting from your friends, or posting from public page, and posting from maybe city information, a group information. So you have a steady feed stream of different ranking scores, but how do you make sure that you serve your user like non-repeated feeds? And each time you look at the feeds that you reach, you know, return user highest ranking score, non-rate feeds.
So then we need to have a filter service, right? Then to every time before this service returns the post list, we can go to this filter service to filter all the retained posts. In here, we can maintain, a bloom filter. Let's see. Filter. Like for this one, in the bloom filter, we can use a. We can use a. Post ID or the add ID to do the filtering. However, there's a thing like, yeah.
So why do we need a bloom filter here? What's, you know, first, what's the bloom filter and why, what's the use case for bloom filter?
Like one user can suppose we return user this post line 1 2 1 1 2 7. So the 6, it is the ads. And then next time when he come back to query the feed service and get the new list one. So we still have this at 6 here, but we don't want to return the this ad to user again.
Yeah, so you don't want to return something you already showed to a user, right? You don't want
Yeah.
to show the user repeated information.
Yeah.
So, but bloom filter is to filter, you know, in a sparse map. Bloom filter is in a sparse map. You don't you want to identify the potential marked you know, if an object existing in this sparse map. And I don't think it's a sparse map here. Like the data is very sparse here. Because you generate a feed for each of the user. It's not really a sparse, right?
Yeah,
So
but for the this could be sparse, right?
here, I think you're still using the you know, you still push your ads to the push your ads to
Feed server.
the feed service.
Yeah.
But I do see a point on the sparse map here. The sparse, I think the public page and the user, public page post and the user maybe sparse that. Sparse, like if it's a public figure, for example, it has a lot of followers. If an influencer publish a feed and if you view the feed, that's probably a bloom filter. I think that could be a potentially bloom filter. Because that's a sparse app, sparse map.
Like also, we suppose that the recommendation could be the recently one, recent post. Like we don't re recommend 1 year ago or 3 months ago. So, in this filter service, maintain the bloom filter. We can only store the data for maybe a recent 1 month. So we for let's say we only reserved for the 1 week. Like the key should be user ID plus the post ID. So see this, we have several things. Like for this one, it's this week. This week means all the post ID generated in this week, then the fil bloom filter the filter operation will go to this one. So there could be last week. There could be 2 weeks ago. So every week, suppose we only maintain 3 weeks, then every week, if this is we reach to the next week, then we can just delete this one and then start a new one. So it's kind of a scroll service to deprecate the old data and only maintain the latest data. So every time there is a new recommendation, it will go to the corresponding filter service to check if the user already got this fit.
Okay, I think it makes sense. You don't want to filter it forever. Here, I just want to mention, 我最后还想提一下，就是你这个 blue filter 其实你是一个 hybrid model， 所以你的 blue filter 是只 apply 去那个 influencer 的 post， 因为你这个 user friends post 其实是非常一个 condensed 一个非常 dense 的一个 post list 是吧？所以你那块你的 filter 应该是不用 blue filter， 用一个不同的东西来 filter 的吧？ 你 Bloom filter 肯定是一个 sparse 的一个 map， 你这个 map 就是这个你这个 x 轴和纵轴它这个点是比较零星的，你才去做 Bloom filter 吧？你这个这种的话，像比如说那个一个 influencer 的 post， 然后对于所有的 user 有没有看过的 influencer 的 post， 这个做 Bloom filter 是 make sense 的。但是你是个 hybrid model 嘛，你还有个 user 这个 feed user home 那个 timeline 这个 table 嘛，就是 user feed service。你其实这个 feed service， 你理论上来说要一个一个读的嘛，那你这个用 Bloom filter 就不 make sense 吧？我理解这样的话也是很
sparse
的。你如果是那样子的话，你是一个 list 啊，我觉得做 Bloom filter 其实是一个 overkill 吧，并且它这个，我总体感觉是不适用于做 Bloom filter 啊。你实际上就可以 mark 那个 feed as read 嘛，就是你 read 了以后，你就把这个 feed 说，我这个 feed 一 read 过了，然后你再读的时候跳过 feed 一就行了嘛。那它得是存在一个
DB 或者一个 catch 里面，对吧？啊，就存在一个对
Redis 啊 ，Memcache 啊，找个 in memory 的 DB 就行了嘛。你读的时候就
cache 它会一直 clean 的呀，对吧
？cache 会一直 clean 的，为什么会一直 clean 呢？因为我可能只
maintain 100个 post line。
哦，对，200个，你把那个 post 上面标上读过就行了。但是，比如说我的
post， 比如说我就产生一些 add， 我这个 add 不存在这个里面，我这个 add 就是用一些其他的那个 GGG service。
对啊，你的 add 和 influencer 的 post， 你是 hybrid model 吗？一方面是你有一个 steady 的一个。 你有一个 sequence 有这个 feed 吗？可能是不是 influencer post 的？那这个的话，你就直接 mark 它 读过没有就行了嘛。那另一方面的话是 influencer 的，那个就有点用 normalized data model 来做这个 join 嘛。那你这个的话是可以用 Bloom filter 的嘛？哦，对，它已有的
data 在这里面是可以存起来的，其他你可以存起来，就是
read not 就行了嘛。你就是已有的 data 你加个 Bloom filter 的话，其实你这个 use case 不对嘛？就是 Bloom filter 不是 sparse 吗？ Sparse map 这个不是 sparse map 吧？这个你这个 map， 你如果把它变成一个 map 的话，在 map 里面任何一个 post 你都很快就要读到了。但是
user ID 加 post 的就是完全不一样的呀。你 post ID 它是连续的。对，是这样子吗？就是我想想怎么说啊？你读这个
user home line 这个 table 的时候，你不是从一个 sparse 的一个 map 里读的。 你 logical 上是个 sparse map， 就是从逻辑层上是个 sparse map， 但是你从那个实践层上，你就从一个 table 里面读的，就从 table 里面读出这个给我准备好的一个 feed， 所以你读的时候就是读这个 feed， 然后是给我准备的 feed 啊，就是这个，所以你其实不是一个 sparse map， 但是你读这个，你要读，比如说这个 influencer 的 post 和这个 user 之间关系是不是可读的，这个是个 sparse map， 因为在这个实践的时候，你也是个 sparse map，
对，在这里面。 的确是我们可以存在这里面，对吧？嗯，对，是这么说的吧？嗯，是要，我看林少在，林少，你这块有什么额外要说的吗？点评的吗？因为是要在这个
Facebook 工作了5年了。啊，大家听得到吗？啊，你能听得到？我刚刚在干活，没有太认真听。哦，就。
feeds 没有那么熟 ，ads 比较熟一点 ，feeds 没有那么熟。那个，你们的问题是什么？
它这块用了，就是也没有什么问题吧？就是你看有什么做的不一样的地方？就是这块是用了一个 normalized model 和 denormalized model 嘛？然后 normalized model 是 influencer 的话用个 normalized model 嘛？所以它读，如果是你读 influencer 的 post 的话，你是 join 它的 post table。然后是如果你是读 friends 的话，你 friends 不是一个 influencer 的话，它是就是把那个 data fan out 到你各个 user 的 home table， 就是那个 home page 的这个 timeline table 里面。然后你读的时候是从这个 timeline table 里读，然后再读上你的那个你 follow 的 influencer 的 post，然后那你要鉴别怎么样是哪一部分是可读的话，哪一部分已经读过的话是如果是 influencer 的 post 的话，是个 sparse map 是个 sparse map 是用这个 bloom filter 来看你是不是读过这个 influencer 的 post 嘛，然后其实不用 bloom filter 行，你直接读一个 last view history 行，就是 view history 也可以吧，就是读起来。然后，如果是你这个给你生成的这个 homeline，就是 home 的 timeline table 的话，你就是读过的话，就把它 mark 成读过。然后你所有的 subsequent 读的话，你是跳过你读过的 phase 嘛。然后这边所有的 phase 呢，是用 rank phase，没有用是 machine learning，不管是用 machine learning 来自于 machine learning 啊，还是来自于这个 ads 啊，就是你就是块儿，如果你想这个给一个 user 的 home 的 timeline table 里面 insert phase 的话，你要给我一个 feed，然后 content，然后再加一个 recommendation score 嘛，然后它按这个 recommendation score 更 relevant 更排到前面，然后 less relevant 排到后面一点。就是听一下你的想法，因为我感觉毕竟在 Facebook 工作这么久嘛，有什么 comments 啊？
我是有点，好，我不知道怎么讲啊，就我比较熟这样子，但是我知道每一个，就是大家看到 timeline 或者 wall 或者是 feed，他们 implementation 可能都不太一样，像 IG 跟 FB 的 timeline implementation 也不一样，但是 idea 上应该是就是有 recommendation 有 score 有 ranking 那个。大部分是就是那个是有的，但是我印象中每一个系统好像是完全不一样。就是 groups 的那个叫 wall，叫 mall groups 的那个叫 mall，然后 feeds 的是我自己的一套，然后 IG 又不一样，IG 的全部都是走另外一套 system，叫做 shots。所以我现在。因为我刚没有完全 follow 中间这个 design 这些失误，所以那个我刚刚在修一个比较严重的 bug，所以我现在比较没有办法直接 direct comment 东西，
好吧，
但是
没事。
对。
您可以简单说一下，就是里面就是大概怎么设计的，high level 的可以讨论一下吗？就是怎么样设计的，简单聊一下。或者不
你
可以
说
啊？
跑到 core infra 东西哦，core
就是，
infra 东西，因为最早版本跟现在已经应该差的非常非常远，最早版本跟现在差的非常远。那个，如果是什么啊？那个怎么讲啊？就是如果例如说像举例 ads 好了，ads 好像。就是你想要不 show 给 user，就是 repetitive 的东西的话，那就是基本上你是在做一个叫做 real time streaming 的 system，那而且要 low latency，就是你的那个 response time 要非常非常快，就是所以那个好像 industry 有两种做法吧，一种做法是就是用那个 batch 加 streaming 的那个。Plus，那叫做什么？Lambda architecture，我有点记不起来那个名字。
Lambda
对对
architecture，对，叫
对
Lambda architecture，对的。
对，这是一个那个，就是一个常见的做法。那你就的困难点就在于，你又有 real time 的东西，然后又有一个 batch 的东西，例如说 Spark 加什么 Storm，那你中间要怎么去取舍？因为 batch 的 characteristic 跟那个 streaming 是不一样，那这个是那个就是业界常见做法，但是那个我记得 Facebook 的那个做法是完全不一样，就是 他做法就是有一个 serving system 啊，叫做 ads indexer 吧，ads finder ads indexer， 那它是 centralized run 那个叫做 apps finder 吧，就是它是一个 apps finder fan out 到很多 apps index，然后每次有 query 的时候 read 的时候就不断的建 index 吧，在 high level 是这样，就是 index 是 highly parallelized，然后它们之间。就是等于说，user 的 information 是 not as find as find the fan out 到很多 index，然后 fetch 在一定的时间内 return 就是 relevant as list，那你就，例如说非常多个 list return 回来，那如果太久 timeout 那个就直接就可能就 drop 掉，然后 as finder 之后还要再做一次 aggregate，就是所谓的 ranking 的部分，所以 sourcing 的部分是 find sourcing 给那个 index，然后 return 之后再 merge，然后那个叫做 ranking 的部分。那 IG 又怎么不一样？它中间层是一个叫 SHA 的东西，就是它不是 find index，它是有一个叫 SHA 词，然后呢，它的另外一个 ranking 是一种叫什么啊？叫 bar keep 啊，反正那个但就是 high level 是这样，但它里面很多细节又不太一样。我要复习一下，我才能够把它点评出来。
OK，所以它这块其实还是就是把它 find out 了嘛，就是你给一个 as，然后写到更，相当于是写 index，就是不一定是直接写到 user 的这个，不一定是直接写到 user
没有。
timeline，但是它其实是写到 user 的这个 predicate 的一个 timeline，就是比如说18岁，我懂了，就是这个 as，比如说你 post 一个 as，说我不是说直接 map 到这个 user，我更多是 map 到比如说18岁男性，比如说白人。然后在这个California，然后我读的时候，如果我满足这个 user 的 trace 和它满足，我就读到这个 as，是这样子吧？类似的。
他就是他，对他基本上不会，就是因为我刚刚没有 follow 你们那个 table 怎么存，他不会就是说直接把哪些东西就是说直接存在一起。
所以它其实增加了一个中间层，就是把 user 呢，就是把那个
他这
as
个，
呢，
对他 add placement insertion 是另外做的，就是在 render feed 的时候，你可以想说。Render feed content 是一个 concurrent path，然后 adds insertion 是另外一个 concurrent 的 path。
所以这个比较 make sense，因为你其实这个as 的对 as 的这个 feed 确实不一样嘛。feed 的话，你可能也有跟它根据其他的 trace 来做，但 as 的话，这个确实是比较相对来说也比较 intuitive，因为你 post as 的时候，你也要说，比如说我这个 target 的用户就是50岁以上的女性是吧？50岁以上中西部女性是吧？你就 post 到50岁以上中西部女性。然后你这个，然后你就那个 score 也比较高一点，是吧？然后如果你来一个 user 的话，你就读这个50岁以上中心，如果你是满足这个的话，你会读到这个，是吧？但是你 post 的时候，其实是你 as 其实是没有说是直接把 as push 到 user 的 timeline，但你是 push 到一个 user 的 trace timeline。然后你 user 如果满足其中几个 trace 的话，你会 adjust 这个 score，然后再决定读不读。然后最后的话，aggregate 一下。然后如果
对，
find out 的话，timeout 就 timeout。
所以 feed 本身跟 social graph 比较 tightly coupled，就是你现在跟你的那些 friends 这个 static 就比较 static 的那个 social graph 的状态，就是会去 driven 你的 feed 怎么显示。但是 as 就完全不一样，as 跟你当时发的那个 request 当下的一些信息再去 driven，所以跟你 social graph 其实是比较远，就是它并不是 anchor 哦。说 social graph，就是我大概如果要很 high level 讲话是这样，可是对啊，就是这样。可是 groups 就简单很多，groups 基本上它那个叫 mole 啊，它那个就比较是早期发展，我记得应该是 chronological，就是 reverse chronological 的做法，所以就是它比较没有 sourcing 和 ranking，它是一个就是比较基于那个 query 吧，就是怎么讲啊？就是它 querying 就是有一套系统，就是 API 类的叫 GraphQL，但是它本身的 return 的那个 order 是它的那个有一个 intrinsic order，那个就是怎么说啊？就是 GraphQL 是基于在掏 cache 类上的东西，那掏每一笔资料其实有一个 timestamp，所以那个 timestamp 是它的那个 intrinsic 的 order，所以那个 response 回来的时候，如果你没有加条件的话，一般就是那个 intrinsic order，所以是在 application layer 再去调整它的那个就是显示的那个顺序，这好像是 groups 的做法，他们没有太 fancy 的东西。
那这边的话，Facebook 现在主要用的是 TauDB 呢，还是那个Cassandra 这个 DB？
哦，IG 是在 Cassandra 上，那个 Facebook 大部分是在 Tau 上，Tau 是一
现在
个
是 Tau 上。
cache layer，Tau 是 cache layer 底层是一个叫 UDB 的东西，其实基本上就是基于 MySQL 吧。如果
对
你要
，sharded
有
MySQL。
strong consistency 的话，是基于 UDB，但是如果你不需要 strong consistency 的话，例如说你只要 read after write 这种 consistency 的话，那可能会有一些 KV store，像是 ZPDB 是一个基于 RocksDB 的嘛，RocksDB 是基于那个 LevelDB 的一个改版的东西，所以那
对。
个，所以这个就是怎么讲啊？就是跟 IG 完全不一样，IG 是完全基于 Cassandra，所以 IG 在那个 consistency 上就会蛮就是相对弱。
OK，make sense，make sense。这块的话，这个 TauDB 其实跟 Uber 的 Schemaless 有点像，但是它增加那个 shard key，所以它你实际上是可以specify 的 partition key 的。然后其次的话，TauDB 它不只是一个 DB，它实际上也把它那个就是它这个 data model 和这个 philosophy 写进去了。它这个 TauDB 是个 graph 嘛，就是它把它认为这个叫它认为这个所有的这个 Facebook feeds comment 和 Facebook like 都是叫 heterogeneous graph，就是heterogeneous graph 怎么翻译成中文？就是 heterogeneous graph，就是说白了是你这个 node 可以是一个 user，你这个就是 graph 里面 node 可以是个 user，可以是个 post，然后可以是一个 location。所以你比如说，假设我比如说我和林世尧去一个月前去 Golden Gate Bridge，然后去 hiking 了，是吧？那我 post 的一个状态，然后另一位同学景祥表示 like 这个 post，那其实这个就是个 graph 嘛，这里面的 entity 就是entity 什么呢？就是我和林世尧，然后另一个 entity 是什么呢？Golden Gate Bridge，然后另一个 entity 是什么呢？就是这个 post 本身，然后还有一个 like 呢？like 是一个 relationship，是一个 age，就是在那个 graph 里面一个 age，然后这个 entity 是景祥，所以是相当于是我和林世尧作为两个 entity，同时在这个 post 中被。就是 related to 这个 post，然后这个 post related to Golden Gate Bridge，然后这个 post 呢，同时 related to 景祥，然后景祥呢跟景祥的关系是被景祥 like 了，所以是这个 relationship 是 like，所以它变成了一个 heterogeneous graph，就是它这个里面 heterogeneous graph 说的 node 可以是任何 entity，然后这个 relationship 可以是 like，可以是 post，然后可以是跟这个 post 相关，也有可能是。就比如说这个 location 是吧？位于这个 location，还有很多其他的可以，也有可能是 ownership 啊，这个 relationship 相对来说比较多元化一点。所以它这个 TauDB 呢，不只是 sharded SQL，sharded MySQL 加一个 caching layer，它 caching 其实它那块写的也挺复杂的，写的挺多的。它是一个 multi data center replicated caching，multi data center replicated caching，然后它同时呢也把这个就是这个。这个 graph 的这个 data model 的 philosophy 写进去了。
它的 cache 蛮复杂，它 cache 有好几层，它有 one region 的 cache 叫 main cache，有 multi region 叫做 multi master tile，就是每个 region 有一个 master。那 fine tune 就是看你 region 要切多细。那个，但是大部分状况还是 single master tile 吧，multi master tile 只有在那个，就是你 performance，对，就是你有一些那个 latency 的一个 constraint，所以它其实就没有办法用一个很简单的 design 来概括它所有的状况。我相信应该是不同的状况，他们用的 cache 都完全不一样。所以那个不太能够用几句话概括起
对，所以如果有这么多 cache 的话，有几
来。
个常见的问题是，你刚写了的 post 就是 read or write 这个 assumption 其实是 比较难 guarantee 的，所以你这个一个是 read write assumption， 就是其次的话，你可能会出现 lost update 是吧？就是或者叫这个就是 linearity 可能会被 violated 比如说你读的时候，你本来是你朋友读的时候，你刚 post 了一个 post， 然后又 delete 掉了，或者比如说你刚 post 了一个 post， 然后你 user A 读了以后，然后看到这个 post， 然后 user B 在读的时候却没有看到这个 post， 这个其实是就是 violation of the linearity 是吧？我们刚就是上周四刚讨论 violation of linearity， 其实这个是比较难 guarantee 的你可能需要 special 设计。但是如果你没有设计好的话，这个因为你有这么多层 cache， read or write 这个 violation 可能是也是有的，就是你刚写完以后再读的时候读不到你的 write， 所以我觉得这个可能不同。
没错，就是我觉得他们是不同 farting 之后决定不同 take style， 就是如果你只看存封的时候，大部分就是例如说选 Taco 就是一个 pure in memory 的 cache， 就是没有不是 persistent。然后 anyway 就是这个要跟每一个 team 谈过，知道他们哎你们最后选什么，才会知道他们说就是 trade off 他们牺牲的哪些东西。
那这边的话，是不是你就作为一个 user 来说，他所有读过的 phase 应该是要被记录一下了吧？就是他 user 读过哪些 phase 是要被记录一下的吧？
嗯，应该是有，对，肯定。
嗯。OK，I、okay, see。
对于 read your rights 这个东西，其实有很多 hanky 的方法吧。就比如说像 Facebook 这种东西，你 post 上去之后，你其实前端可以做一些 tricky 的东西。也不一定全需要 DB 存储层。
前端的话会有一个问题是，就是你可能是 multi device 的，就是你比如说你手机 post 了一个，然后用这个 desktop pull 了一下，然后没读到的话，也是影响 user experience。
对，但那个是小 case 了。但
大部分产品并不保证 multi device， 这是我的理解。很多产品组他们并不保证 consistency across device。
对，简单确实也可以做的，就是你读的时候，实际上你就不从 DB 读了，你读的时候就从 local 读就行了，从 mobile 上读就行了。
mobile 部分他们 optimization 我相信绝对不 consistent， 因为他们好像是 in favor prefetch 吧，所以其实你 mobile 上看到很多 data 都是事先读好，不是 real time， 所以是通常是你在 start app 的时候就 prefetch 很多东西，所以我觉得你的看到的东西绝对是比较 delay， 就是主要是在 App Store 还是
我有几个问题还是挺有趣的，就是你们来说，就是 Facebook 里面来说，读 Ads 的 SLA 和读 Face 的 SLA 一般是多少？
这个我没有让他们 call， 所以我不知道。我知道那个 IG Product 的 SLA 是3.9，没有很大。
就是 availability 是3.9，但是 latency 的 SLA 呢？
latency 看不同的产品，如果是 feed 会特别 tight 的吧。feed 我记得好像我忘了它实际上速度，但是它 regression 是很严格，我记得好像 0.2 0.3 的 regression 都是有问题。
就是
0.2% 的 regression， 就是 latency regression 他们基本就过不去了。
所以它这个 SLA 是，就是 latency SLA 是非常严格的，是吧？
但实际上的那个他们现在的数字，因为我们去他们组上 code， 我有点忘了，但是我大概知道他们 latency 是 feed 上比较 concern latency。
OK， 相对来说，这个 latency 肯定还是很影响，因为你毕竟是 monitorized 的，这个你要是读的1秒钟没刷出来，可能就不看了。
对，所以很多怎么说啊，很多 hacky 的东西既然在 application 上做，例如说 image 的部分，他们有那种，就举个例好，就是我不知道现在还是这样，就是我以前看过，他们有那个把 image hash 成一个那个 base 64， 就一段一小段 string， 然后那个在 prefetch 的时候就读下来，所以你就有一个很 blurry 的 image 就先 display。然后之后那个真正的 image 才是从 CDN 过
来，就是为了优化这个 CDN 这个 latency， 就是先读一个 base64 的，然后显示一个非常模糊的，然后再从 CDN 读到 image 来读。
对，可是这应该也是好一阵子，我也不知道他们现在有没有再去改进这个事情。
OK，你还有什么额外的有趣的信息跟大家分享吗？
是，就 AHA 的东西太多了，但是我不知道要怎么比较有系统讲，因为实际上你要说 up to date information 真的是每一组都有自己的 hack。所以我不知道我讲这些比较 AHA 的东西对大家有没有帮助，因为其实比较就是你没有 context 你也不知道为什么这样搞，因为 Facebook 很多 practice 跟 industry 都不一样，像那个 Lambda architecture 我们就没在用。
Lambda
我觉得
Lambda architecture 挺常见的，其实它虽然是最早好像是 Twitter 的一个 engineer 推出的，但是其实应用的地方挺常见的，像 Uber 也有一个 Lambda architecture， 是那个 Pidget 是其实也是一个 Lambda architecture。Lambda architecture 其实是虽然是提出的时候是for whatever reason， 但是其实在工业界应用还挺常见的。好，对啊，我觉得相对来说还是比较有趣的，就是你其实这个中间这个 Facebook 这个怎么样做这个 phase 啊 ，management 啊，然后 database choice 啊，然后像社交现在管理的那个 Cassandra nodes 也4-5000是吧？应该是最大的 Cassandra nodes 啊 cluster 啊。好的，好，我们还有5分钟啊。然后我这边说一下，我觉得就是李翔这个设计，我觉得没有问题的，就是中间有一些discussion 呢，也是没有问题的。然后我觉得表达的话可能上来说就是说你要做一个 hybrid model 比较重要，我觉得这样的话否则的话那面试官可能一上来会有很多问题，但你要说上来说是个 hybrid model 的话，我觉得可能就面试官的问题就会少很多。然后我们这块的话没有 cover 一些 feature design， 就比如说是怎么样设置一下 comments 啊，怎么样设置一下 like 啊，然后这些没有 cover 啊。但是这个的话其实大家我觉得最好的还是读一下那个 Facebook 投的 paper， 这个 paper 其实写的非常不错的，我觉得写的是非常不错的，对于问题理解也很深。然后你读完这个讨的 paper， 然后你可以在就是 subsequently 读一下这个 schemaless 的，然后 schemaless Uber schemaless designs 也有 engineering block 的，没有写 paper， 但是有个 eng block Uber eng block 写 schemaless 的。然后你可以想一下为什么，如果 Uber 的同学的话，可以想一下为什么从 schemaless 到 Dockstar 了啊，这还是有原因的，就从 schemaless 到 Dockstar 还是有原因的啊，并且你可以读一下 Dockstar 的这个设计，还有他怎么样做了哪些 improvement。这个其实好像你就直接 search Facebook 淘，我也忘了哪个期刊上的，就直接 search 就可以。然后这块设计我总体来说我觉得思路还是蛮清晰的，有一些 detail 的事情，就是可能要再写一些细一些，比如说你可以这块的话我觉得可以写一个对于一个 phase 来说一个 life cycle 怎么样的，然后对于一个 user 来说你来自于不同的 phase 怎么样子的，然后这块的话 use phase这个 Facebook phase 的话，你肯定还是要提个 ranking 的 Facebook phase 的 ranking 和 score 这个就是没有提到吧，但是这个其实明显是很重要的一部分，因为你这个50个 user 每个 pass 500个 user 每个人 post 的这个500个 phase 其实25000个 phase， 那我怎么样显示200个 phase 是吧？25000怎么样百里挑一选到200个就让 user addictive 的这个 addicted 的这个 phase， 其实是非常有研究的，然后可以优化很多的。然后对，然后这边的话石耀也分享了一下这个就是现在 Facebook 用什么 database 啊，我觉得这还是挺有趣的，然后包括怎么样把这个 ads push 到 related user， 它不是 push 到每个 user 的这个 timeline， 它是 push 到一个 group of user 是吧， group of user trees， 然后从 group user trees 找见更 match 的 user 然后 push 过去。好，李翔你有什么额外想说的吗？
我就想问这个，因为我之前跳槽的时候，那时候面的系统设计其实也挺简单的，因为当时在工作一年多。然后现在这个就是因为这次 mock 嘛，就相当于不是那么的完整，就是一般 design 的时候不都会涉及到 data schema 怎么设计嘛？就比如说这里面有好几个 storage， 每一个 storage 要怎么设计？这个一般是说。我们给面试官说完了这个 OOU 的 architecture， 然后就开始进入底层的这些东西。
对 ，schema 是和 database 相关的，你必须根据就是这面的话，首先我觉得流程最好的是这样，就是你首先计算一下这个 scalability 是吧？就是你QPS 是多少，然后 read write ratio 是多少，然后 read QPS 多少 write QPS 多少，然后再根据你的需求 选择一下这个 database 是吧？你是 read heavy 还是 write heavy？ 然后这个选择一下 database， 然后根据 database 设计 schema， 因为你这个 DynamoDB 或 Cassandra 的 schema 和这个 MySQL 的，包括 Sharded SQL 的都是完全不一样的。如果你用 Facebook 淘的话，你 partition key 怎么设计是吧？啊，包括你用 Cassandra 的话，你 partition key 怎么设计 ，primary key 怎么设计也是不一样的。所以这个 schema database schema 肯定和 database 是这个选什么 database 是直接相关的嘛？然后。所以这个甚至有时候你可能设计完了以后发现之前的不对，可能也要推到重来一遍也有可能，就是你最后所以一定要把那个 requirement 这个 trade-off 写到最前面，就 trade-off 写到最前面。你比如说这个的话，我们看这个 Facebook 这个 phase 设计，其实这个 latency 是更重要的。 availability 三个九其实很糟糕了，三个九 一年可以 down 八个小时，这个 availability 其实很糟糕，但这个 latency 要是多0.2% 都是过不了的话，这 latency 其实是最重要的，所以你必须把这个 trade off 写到前面，然后再选 architecture， 设计 architecture， 选 database， 然后再设计 data schema。如果不 work 的话，还得推倒重来一遍，这个是很正常的。
但是算这些东西的话，就直接就超过了15分钟了，我估计。
我个人建议算的时候快一点，这个算的其实相对来说。说实话你是四个九还是五个九我并不 care、啊、十的四次方还是十的五次方我并不 care、啊、因为这个 horizontal scalable 现在都是用 horizontal scalable 的、啊、你这个对于淘来说你加几个 server 或者减几个 server、啊、就是你比如说四个九变成五个九你可能加十倍的 server、啊、反正来都无所谓的，像 Uber 的 schemaless 也是一样的、啊、四个九五个九并不是很 care， 你可以自己把这时间压缩到几分钟之内，你表示你有这个 keep 这个 in mind。 然后最主要的是最主要的三个方面，最主要的三个方面是 architecture、database 和 data model。然后 database 那块的话，你很多时候是要根据你的 isolation level 啊、consistency level 啊，然后来选这个 database。所以这块的 discussion 可以很多，也可以很深入的。data schema 的话 ，data model 和 data schema 的话，你必须在 database 之后才能选，因为不同 database 的 schema 是完全不一样的。我觉得对，然后并且这样的话，一般来说，你看你面试什么 level 了？如果面试 senior level 的话，任何问题都有可能问。senior level 是任何问题都有可能问，就是，因为这个，我觉得 computer science 瓶颈期比较早，就是到 senior 就是个 terminal level 嘛 ，senior 往上是不要求的，所以到 senior level 就 suppose 你能做任何 independent 做任何东西了，所以任何问题都有可能问，所以这个对。可能这个 system design 会更难一点。
好的。
好，
我没什么问题。
好的，我没有什么其他同学有什么额外的问题吗？我可以回答一下。或者直接说就可以了。没有的话就到这儿好了。我再等十秒钟，如果没有的话就到这儿好了。
有个问题，就是你刚刚说那个 Bloom Filter 那个 Filter Service， 你打算是怎么做呀？就是这个 Filter Service， 就是你是要用什么 DB， 还是想用别的？就怎么做这个东西
？Bloom Filter 是 Memory， 你就直接申请一个 Memory 块，然后里面都是一个 B 一个 B 的嘛。然后你用
那就是有那是不是就是这个就比较就不太那么 scale 啊？就是啊。
Bloom Filter 是为了省内存啊，你也可以用什么 Memcache 或 Redis 来做，甚至你可以用 DB 来做，但是就是会慢嘛，然后费内存。
那你那个就只能在单台机器上了，对吧？就是你就是在 in-memory 单台机器上搞。
你可以单台机器，对。
Bloom Filter 可以非常 efficient。我记得好像那个群里面有一位专门研究 database 的同学发了一个 PhD， 发了一个那个 Bloom Filter。我看了一下，他说，8GB 的 memory， 其实这个 Bloom Filter 的 duplication rate 就很低了。你可以算一下，我觉得他有几个指标的，就是什么，一个是 k， 一个是 value， 还有一个什么，有个 p 值什么的，反正就是它有不同的。但是总体来说，你有8GB 的 memory， 它这个 duplication rate 就很低了。你可以读一下那块，我觉得这个还是挺 efficient 的。之前有人发过，还是挺 efficient 的。你有什么问题吗？静怡。
我想问一下，就是那个，在那个就 store 自己的 feed 的时候，就 store 各种 user 的 feed 的时候，是它 通常是按时间顺序去 store， 但是 read 的时候，它的排序有可能是按照一定的 ranking 去serve 吗？
这样的话，其实这个 store 的时候就应该按 ranking 来 store。
哦 ，store 的时候就按 ranking 来 store。
对你读的时候就按 ranking 来读，你如果按时间 store 来 ranking， 再按 ranking 来读的话，这个本身就不是很合理。
I see.
你 store 的时候就你没必要显示最新的嘛，只不过最新的 ranking 会更高嘛。你比如说你的 ranking score 里面可以你的 ranking 不一定是固定死的值啊，你的这个 ranking 可以加一个 time decation 嘛，就是你 ranking 比如说十小时前 ranking 是十的，那你和一小时前 ranking 是十的，你肯定会 decay 它嘛，你可能会有个 decay algorithm 去 decay 它的那个 ranking 值。
I see. 那所以是在他 fan out 的时候就已经把 ranking 算了。
对，你的 ranking 值只是说当时这块有肯定有很多优化的地方了我直观猜想就是你 ranking， 比如说你十小时前 ranking 是十的，然后那你和一小时前 ranking 是十的，那你肯定有个 decaying， 就是 decay 一下之前的 ranking 值嘛，你用一个指数型 decay 就可以了。
对。然后我发现这个 Facebook 要是我打开第一次打开然后过五分钟再打开，然后前面的五个 feed 都是不一样的，这个是不是它我每次 read 完之后它这个 ranking 都会 upgrade， 就是 ranking 都会 update？
对，然后它 ranking 肯定和时间是相关的嘛，你 ranking 最后的 ranking score 肯定和你读的时间相关嘛。因为你 ranking score 你不可能说每小时后再把 user 的 ranking score 全部改一下，然后把所有的 user ranking score 降低个一什么的，这不可能的。所以你 ranking score 肯定是有时效性的，然后你读的时候根据你的时间把你的 ranking score discount 嘛。然后你读的时候你读这个就是你 refresh 的时候你肯定是说哎，我把所有的就是没有读过的，我现在对这个 user 来说我把所有的没有读过的 feeds然后再按 ranking 的从高到低然后显示一遍，我觉得这样比较 make sense 一点。
对，它可能是先 filter and read 的。
然后这块有个同学问几年算 senior， 这个其实时间比较 flexible， 有十几年多的 senior， 也有三年的 senior， 两年的 senior。 我们组最年轻的一个 senior 2只有三年半的工作经验，他本科毕业三年半就是 senior 2了。但是他是这种原因他是美国本地人，然后他其次的话从九岁就开始编程local， 然后九岁开始编程，所以他这个三年半就升到 senior 2了。senior 的话我觉得是从三年到十五年甚至二十年都正常嘛。depends on 你想 take 多少 responsibility， 你有时候有非常有野心的人 ambitious 的人可能三年就想面一个 senior 职位，有的人的话他看都不一样，他可能二十年的话做 senior 也挺好的所以没有一个 hard answer， depends on 你自己觉得能不能做 senior。 好，如果没有额外问题就到这里好了今天非常感谢大家，然后下周还有一个 mock interview， 下周 mock interview candidates 比较强他上来说自己想做 candidates 还是可以做 interviewer 都可以所以我们下周到时候看讨论一个什么题目他应该有很多 interview 的 experience， 所以我也不知道能不能 interview 他或者说可能会他出的想的地方比我更全面一点，我还是比较期待的下周的这个 interview。 非常感谢大家到这里为止，好，谢谢大家。